God bless you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. God is here tonight. Hello. Praise the Lord. And so if God is here tonight, the healing presence of the Lord is here. Isn't that right? So there's no lack of power. If you don't receive any power tonight, it's just because you didn't plug into it. Hello? You know, Jesus went down to his hometown, and he was just as anointed there as he was anywhere else, but nobody received anything. Why? Because nobody plugged into the power. Isn't that right? Nobody plugged into the power. Hallelujah. And so we can plug into the power. You see, God has already done everything he's ever going to do for your healing, your blessing, your prosperity, whatever. He's already done everything he's going to do. Hello? He did it at Calvary. Huh? And it's up to you to receive it. That's all you got to do. You know, when God made promises to Abraham way back in Genesis 12, what did Abraham have to do to receive those promises? Did he have to keep the law? No, the law wasn't even given yet until 480 years after Abraham died. So did he have to earn them? Buy them? How did he get them? Just by believing. That's all he had to do. Well, you're the seed of Abraham. So what do you got to do to receive them? Just believe. You can't earn them. Hello? Isn't that amazing? You know, one time in Canada, I got up one morning and I made a big mistake and I repented of it. And that night I'm supposed to preach. And so I said, God, I'm not going. He said, yes, you are. And I said, no, I'm not. And he said, well, you are. I said, well, I'd have to be the biggest hypocrite in town to go down there and preach. I'm not going down there to preach. And he said, yeah, you're going down there to preach. I said, well, you know what I did this morning. He said, what did you do? I said, what do you mean what did I do? You know good and well what I did. He said, I got no record of it. Hello? I got no record of it. And so I went down and preached that night, and some guy gave me an envelope. When I got home, I opened it up, and there was a $1,000 check. I just started to cry, and I said, God, I don't deserve this. And he said, I didn't bless you because you deserved it. I blessed you because I'm a good God. Hallelujah. Isn't that amazing? Thank you, Jesus. And so God said he's already blessed you with every spiritual blessing in heavenly place in Christ Jesus. Have blessed his past tense. Now, do you have them? Yeah. You got them right there in your Bible. Isn't that right? In seed form. Hello? In seed form. Your Bible, the Bible said the sower sows the word. So your words are seeds. All the blessings are seeds. So how do you get a seed to grow? By planting it. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
And so how do you plant it? By believing with your heart, confessing with your mouth. Well, to believe it, you got to hear it. Hello? You can only believe what you hear.
That's true.
You know, 12 spies went into the promised land. They came back. 10 of them got up, gave one report. 2 of them got up, gave another report. And once the people heard that, they had to make a decision which one they was going to believe. Well, they chose to believe the 10th. Isn't that right? 3.5 billion people died as a result of that believing. And thousands have died in the church believing the wrong thing about healing. Hello? Many of them think God put the sickness on them. Well, he hasn't got any. And he said to pray that God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Isn't that right? You know, if it's God's will for to put sickness on some of us, Jesus would have done that. Because he said he only done the Father's will. But he didn't put sickness on anybody. And God don't use sickness to teach you. He uses the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit teaches you the truth. It's the truth that sets you free. Isn't that right? Hallelujah. And so I had a guy one time in Sri Lanka come to me and argue with me for 3 hours one afternoon on his right to remain saved. I said, well, what in the world did you come see me for? He said, I just thought it was God's will you'd zap me and I'd get healed. I said, well, I've been trying to tell you what God's will is for the last 3 hours. I said, God's will is He's written word. Oh, he said, I wouldn't want to get healed if it wasn't God's will, because if God did, God would get angry with me. I said, are you going to see the doctor? Yeah. Are you taking medicine? Yeah. I said, what if it's God's will not for you not to get healed? And you get healed. I said, if you believe it's God's will for you to be sick, then why don't you go home and throw your medicine away, stop going to the doctor, and enjoy being sick. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. When I got born again, the first week I was born again, I led 5 people to Jesus in a mental hospital being treated for alcoholism and dope. I didn't know nothing about the Bible, but I heard the voice of the Holy Spirit. The second week I prayed for a blind man and got healing. And I was in a church that preached that all that healing had been done away when the last apostle died. Only problem is the last apostle hasn't died yet. There's still apostles today, just like there was 2,000 years ago. The Bible says that God put in the church apostles, prophets, evangelists, teachers, and pastors until we all come into the unity of the faith. Well, that's never happened yet. We got 9,000 different denominations, and most of them are teaching something different. And so we've not come into the unity of the faith. You know, in South America, if this meeting was held here tonight, all the churches in this community would be in this meeting. Hello? Why? Well, they come together in unity in the South America. And so the whole cities are being converted in different parts of South America. Hallelujah. And so it can happen right here in New Zealand. You know, the Holy Spirit has been wanting to bring revival to New Zealand for a long, long time. He's moving back and forth on New Zealand. Just waiting for somebody to give him, like Ezekiel, give him direction on what to do. You know, the Holy Spirit was here in the beginning, moving back and forth on the face of the deep. He was doing nothing until God said, light be. And when God said, light be, He created 186 billion miles of light. Hello? Well, He's waiting for that to happen right here in New Zealand. The revival isn't coming down from up there. God isn't the one that decides when we have revival. It said, if my people whom are called by my name, and the word if puts the responsibility for revival right on us. Revival's coming from in here. Every believer has a river on the inside of them. And should be flowing out of us, bringing life and healing and deliverance and prosperity and blessing everywhere we go. But it's not doing that because the river isn't flowing. Now, the disciples in the 10th chapter of Matthew was anointed with the Holy Spirit by Jesus and told that they had power to cast out all unclean spirits and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. By the 17th chapter, they couldn't do it. Why? Because they're feeding their flesh and not their spirit. And that's what's wrong in the church. See, they spend a half an hour in church on Sunday, or at the most an hour, and then go home and feed the rest of the week on the television set, the newspapers, and whatever, and feed their flesh. Well, that's why your flesh is in control instead of your spirit. If you're going to do what Jesus did, you're going to have to be able to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit and obey Him. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. That's what I did right from the word go. I read a scripture that said Jesus said, I only say what my Father tell me to say, and I only do what my Father showed me to do. So I realized if I'm going to have a ministry like Jesus, I had to be able to hear the Holy Spirit and obey Him. So I trained myself to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. The first thing I did is took all the roadmaps out of my car and threw them in the trash can. And I get in my car and say, Holy Spirit, you better know where to go, because if you don't, we ain't going to get there. And He just leads me right to the place. And then I got Him involved in everything. I don't even buy clothes without consulting the Holy Spirit. It's His money, it's not mine. I'm just a steward of it. So I ask Him how to spend it. Hello? I don't buy what I want, I buy what He wants me to have. Hallelujah. And I pay the price He wants me to pay. I don't care what it costs. I know as long as I'm obedient to my Father, He's going to pay the bills. Hello? I don't worry about what the cost is. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. You know, I have traveled to over 120 different countries. Most of those countries, when I've gone to them, I have no contacts, nobody there, just that the Holy Spirit said go. And when I got there, He would always lead me to somebody that was very sick, in desperate situation, and I'd pray for them to get healed, and the next thing I'd have 3-4 weeks of meetings stretched out over 2-3-4 meetings a day. And I never asked for money, and I've never tried to raise finances by itinerating or telling people my itinerary. I don't even tell people what I'm doing. Hallelujah. I don't tell anybody what my needs are. I told my wife when we got married, I said, sweetheart, don't you dare ever tell anybody what we need. I said, you just tell them that our God supplies all our need according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. I said, if they're not in tune with the Holy Spirit, we don't want what they got. I've had people try to give me stuff in the flesh, and I said, no, I don't want it. I don't care how bad I needed it. I wouldn't take it. I started a church in Singapore. The Lord said, put a box by the back door. Tell the people, don't put anything in there unless the Holy Spirit tells you to. I said, and if you put anything in there and it didn't know what the Holy Spirit told you to, I'll call you out and give it back to you. And so several times I called people out and gave the money back to them that they put in there. I said, we don't need your money. You're not our source. We're not asking you to give because we need your money. We're asking you to give so God's got an avenue of blessing you. I said, you're the one that's going to benefit from tithing and giving, not me. I said, I'm not going to benefit unless I tithe and give. Hallelujah. So it's amazing. Go with me in your Bible tonight to Romans 12:3. You know, it's amazing the lifestyle that we're living, a lot of us, when we've got such great faith. Hello? You know, we're down here praying, God, give us more faith. You don't need no more faith. You know, when I was born, I had the same muscles I got right now. Isn't that right? But I couldn't do when I was born what I'm doing now with these muscles. But that took a lot of hours of exercise. Isn't that right? And so faith works the same way. If you never use it, it never gets any stronger. Hello? See, that's what the problem is. We're not using our faith. So we didn't need more faith. What we needed was information from God and how to operate and live by faith. And that's what God taught me. See, He taught me how to live by faith. See, when I went to church, started the church, they told us we had to have faith, but they never told us how to get it. Never told us what it was, never told us how it worked. And so, but they told us if we didn't have faith, we'd go into hell. And so I've written a lot of books, Christian books, and a lot of my books I write how-to. When I flew into Tokyo, Japan in 1975, At 40,000 feet, the Holy Spirit said to me, I want you to teach the people in Asia how to live by faith and who they are in Christ. Well, the moment I started teaching, I was like beating my head right up against a concrete wall. But I just kept beating it until I knocked a hole in it. Now I got people all over Asia teaching. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. And so that's what the first two things we should have been taught when we start the church was how to live by faith and who we are in Christ. If you don't know how to live by faith, then you can't appropriate a single promise from the Bible because they're only available by faith. Is that right? Without faith, it's impossible to please Him. But he that cometh to God must believe that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Now, you notice he went from faith to believing. Now, both faith and believing is almost the same Greek word. But they mean two different things. One of them is a noun and one's a verb. Faith is a noun. It's a person, place, or thing. And Hebrews 12:2 tells you what it is. Looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of faith. So when you receive Jesus Christ in your heart, you receive the God kind of faith. The same kind of faith that God operates with. So you're going to try to tell me it's weak? Hello? Moses used that faith in part of the Red Sea. Joshua used that faith and stopped the whole earth rotating on its axis for 24 hours. And Jesus used that faith and raised the man from the dead, been dead for 4 days. And you got the same kind of faith. Hello? Isn't that right? You got the same kind of faith. Hallelujah. See, the problem's not faith, it's information on how to operate that by that faith. The problem is believing, not faith. Now, believing is a verb and it's an action word. You can always tell what people believe by their lifestyle, by their actions. You know, a lot of times we say we believe the Bible, but our action says we don't. Isn't that right? Glory be to God. Isn't that amazing? And so that's what the problem is believing. We're trying to see that tonight in this message. It's believing that's the problem. It's not faith. Hallelujah. We're down here praying for faith when and you can only believe, according to Romans 10:14, you can only believe what you're hearing. How shall they believe in him whom they've never heard, and how shall they hear without a preacher? So you can only believe what you're hearing. If your hearing's wrong, then your believing's going to be wrong. And if your believing's wrong, you shut your faith down. See, it was like those people that heard those 10 people's report, see, they chose to believe that report. Their believing shut their faith down. Do you understand that? They shut their faith down. Peter got out of a boat one night and literally walked on water, but shut his faith down and began to sink. How did he do that? By taking his focus off of Jesus and looking over the size of those waves. And so when you hear God's word being preached, and then you go to the doctor, and the doctor comes out and gives you a report just contrary to God's word, then what you do is you take your faith off in the word and you put it on what that doctor said. What happens? Same thing happened to Peter, you doubt. Isn't that right? Same thing that happened to Peter. You doubt. And so God said here in Romans 12:3, for I say through the grace given unto me, to every man that is amongst you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now, he's not talking to sinners. He's not talking to every man. He didn't write Romans to every man. He wrote it to the believers. So he's talking only believers here. And so every believer has been dealt the measure of the God kind of faith. You've got great faith. In Daniel, there's a scripture that says, in the last days, my people shall know their God, and they shall do great exploits. Isn't that right? And so we're living definitely in the last days. And we're living in the days when God's people ought to be doing great exploits. Every one of us. And if we're going to get this world, preach the gospel to them, we're going to have to demonstrate to them that with great things. Because they're not going to believe just the preaching of our gospel. You know, T.L. Osborne, I don't know if you know him or not or ever heard of him, but he went out to India, him and his wife, as missionaries when they was 19 and 18 years old. They were there 3 years, and they had three converts. The Muslims kept challenging them. Prove that your Bible is more powerful than the Koran. They couldn't. Hello, they couldn't. So they got three converts. They went back to those faith broken. And their church thought they was a great success. And so they gave them a pastor up by Portland, Oregon. And one night a man of God came to Portland to hold the meeting. They went to the meeting and sat up in the balcony, and he sat there and watched this man just point to people with growths on their body and say, in the name of Jesus, fall off, and they just fall right off on the ground. And he'd seen people get the deaf people healed and all kinds of miracles and happened. And he said, well, God, he said, I serve the same God he does. Why don't those miracles follow me? Well, one night he started a miracle service in his church, but no miracles. So one night, Jesus appeared to him in his bedroom, and he said to him, bow down before me and stretch out your hands. He said, bow down before me, stretched out his hands, and Jesus put one finger in the middle of that hand and one finger in the middle of that hand. He said, now, go back to India. Well, the first meeting he had in India, when he went back to India, he got 80,000 people saved in one meeting. Why? Miracles, signs and wonders. Hallelujah. Isn't that amazing? See, people, those people, you take those religious people, they're not going to believe, they're not going to want to throw away their dead God to your dead God. If your God's not doing miracles, signs and wonders, he's dead. Isn't that right? He's dead. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. You know, the first person I prayed for when I was only 2 weeks old in Jesus was blind. Both eyes, I prayed and God healed him. And then the next person I prayed for was a little girl who took a pistol and tried to blow her brains out. And I prayed for her. Within 3 days, she walked out of the hospital completely normal. And within 3 months, God had me pray and raise three people from the dead. And here's my church telling me I couldn't do it. And telling me that miracles all passed away when the last apostle died. And I said, well, you're too late. See, I'm a walking miracle. They only gave me 6 months to live when I got born again. I had a lot of physical problems, with bleeding ulcers in my stomach, 3/4 permanent brain damage, both kidneys malfunctioning, cirrhosis of the liver so bad I couldn't. I had been pain 24 hours a day, and many other problems, nervous system shock, having delirium tremors, seeing things, you know, that didn't exist. They gave me 6 months at the most. Well, they only missed it by 45 years. Glory be to God, I'm still here. Hallelujah. Why? Because I didn't believe what they said. And I didn't repeat it. Hallelujah. 15 times in my lifetime, I've been told by the medical doctors I was going to die. Nothing they could do for me. But I'm still here. Hallelujah. Why? Well, I didn't believe them. Hello? You know, in the first place, I wasn't worried about dying after I got saved because I knew where I was going. Hello? You know, I'm amazed at how many people tell me they believe they're going to heaven when they die, but they're afraid to die. Glory be to God. You're going to die to get there. Well, even Jesus had to die to get there. Isn't that right? glory be to God. So what are we afraid to die for? You know, I go places to preach the gospel. If they caught me preaching, they'd shoot me. People say, what are you going to do if they shoot you? I said, big deal, graduation day, I'm out of here. Big deal. I ain't worried about that. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. And so God said he's dealt to every one of you, every one of you, the major of the God kind of faith, the same kind of faith that God operates with. Isn't that amazing? So you don't lack faith. Isn't that right? Faith isn't your problem. That's not what's keeping you from receiving. Isn't that amazing? Go with me to Matthew 17, 20. And Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief, for verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Now, did you notice that last part? And nothing shall be impossible unto you. Isn't that amazing? And here we are. I can't do this. I can't do this. I can't do this. Well, the Bible says you can. The Bible said you can do all things through Christ who gives you the ability. Isn't that right? Mm-hmm. And you got the Holy Spirit. He knows everything. Isn't that amazing? Glory be to God. You know, God called me to build a church about 3 months or 4 months after I got saved, sent me to Alaska to build a church. And I said, God, when he told me that, I laughed so hard I almost fell on the ground. That was the funniest thing I've ever heard in my life. I couldn't even saw a board straight. And here he's telling me to go build a church. I said, God, are you crazy? He said, no. He said, you told me you'd do anything I asked you to. I said, well, okay. I said, but I can't do anything. He said, open your Bible up to Philippians 4:13 and read it. So I did, and it said, I can do all things through Christ who gives me the ability. It's that word that can't went off my vocabulary that day. Every job I've had since I've been a Christian, I've known nothing about. But I said, God, you better know more than I know, or we're in trouble. Hallelujah. And I did it. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. You don't have to know a lot. You just have to know the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Now, God said here, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, not the faith the size of a grain of mustard seed. When Jesus said to Peter that night when he walked on water and failed, he said, oh, ye of little faith. What he was not talking about the size of his faith. He was talking about the duration of his faith. Do you understand? It only endured for a short time, as long as he had his focus on Jesus. But what happened when he took his eyes off and Jesus looked over the size of those waves? He began to sink. Isn't that right? Glory be to God. See, when he took his eyes off of Jesus, he disconnected his faith from the power source. And when you take your focus off in God and these promises, then you disconnect your faith from the power source. See, I can tell you the people that's operating by faith when they come up here to prayer, because the ones that are operating by faith ask them to pray for their sickness. Hello? See, they're focused on the problem, not on Jesus. They're not asking me for healing. They're asking for pray for their sickness. Unbelief talks about the problem. Faith talks to the problem and says something to it. What's it say? Be thou removed and cast into the sea. See, unbelief talks about the problem. Hallelujah. And so God said here, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed. Now suppose I had a seed here in my hand and I wanted to produce me a harvest. What do I do with it? Plant it, okay? So when I planted it, what did I do with it? No. gave it a job to do. Isn't that right? To grow me a harvest, isn't that right? So he said faith works the same way. You want faith to work, you got to give it a job to do. That's what the problem is. See, we're not giving our faith any job to do. We're down here asking God to move the mountain, and he didn't say he was going to move the mountain. He said, you're going to move the mountain. You say to the mountain. He didn't say to ask God to say it to the mountain. He said, you say to the mountain. Isn't that right? Isn't it amazing? See, we're not saying anything to the mountains. We're just asking God to do something about it. And we're down here asking God to send revival. Well, the revival's coming as soon as we recognize that the river that's in us is dammed up with unbelief. And get repented of that unbelief, get that unbelief out of there, that river's going to start flowing again. And when it does, it's going to bring life and healing and deliverance and miracles and signs and wonders everywhere we go. Hallelujah. See, you were given the Holy Spirit so that you can manifest Jesus everywhere you go. That's why you're given the Holy Spirit. And if you listen to the Holy Spirit and obey him, then you'll do the works of Jesus. How did he do it? How many works did he do before he got baptized with the Holy Spirit? None. He did them all after he got baptized with the Holy Spirit. And so, seeing so... God said here, if you give your faith a job to do, there is nothing impossible for you to do. Isn't that amazing? My brother-in-law, who's Chinese, lives in Auckland, New Zealand. Him and his team, in the last 2 years, I don't know how many they've done this year, but last 14 and 13, they won 3,500 people to Jesus off the streets of Auckland. Hello? Gets up in the morning, he says, God, I'm believing you for so many souls today. And he gets them. He gets on the airplane, fly to Hong Kong. God, I'm believing you for so many souls on this airplane, on this flight to Hong Kong. He gets them. Hello? He gets up in the morning, says, God, I'm believing you're going to lead me to so many people that are sick, and you're going to let me lay hands on, pray for them, and you're going to heal them. And he gets it. He's on a mission trip right now into China. He's been on, I don't know how many mission trips in the last 3 years. About 5 or 6 years ago, I went to his home, and I said to him, I said, are you talking in tongues? No. I said, why not? He said, because I'm afraid God will make me do what you're doing. Well, he's doing what I'm doing now. Isn't that amazing? He went to Elam Bible School, and he's doing what I'm doing now. And so his whole family's doing it. Hallelujah. I took one of his oldest sons, and Keith, and took him to India and Sri Lanka with me, and I took my nephew to Malaysia with me, and we've had a fantastic time. And the pastor at Elam Bible School told me, he said, I have never seen such a transformation take place in a person's life that took place in your nephew when he went overseas with you. They had a lot of problems with him in the Bible school. But when he come back, a changed person. Hallelujah. See, he thought he was just going to watch Brother Howard, but I made him go right to work and pray for the sick and cast out devils and whatever. I didn't let him stand back there and watch me. Hallelujah. Made him get involved. Hallelujah. And I told him the same Jesus in me, the same Jesus in you. Hallelujah. Now, God said here, if you give your faith a job to do, you know, when I married my wife, she was the only Christian in a Buddhist home. I said to her, don't you dare tell anybody they're a Buddhist. You tell them according to Acts 16:31, they're all saved. So that's what she did. People asked her for family saved. She said, yeah, they're all saved according to Acts 16:31. We never once asked God to save them. Hello? We just stood on the Word of God. And 13 years later, her mother came down to Auckland to visit her daughter and son-in-law. And on Sunday, they went to church. And she didn't want to stay home alone, so she went to church with them. and got saved. Hallelujah. I couldn't preach to her, and she was the most fierce woman I've ever seen. And all the family was scared of her, so nobody translated for me. I couldn't talk Chinese, and she couldn't talk English, and so I couldn't witness to her. I just sat there and smiled at her. Glory to God. Now, so God said here that he's, if you take that faith that you've got, no matter what size it is, it's big enough to do any miracle Jesus did. Hello? Isn't that right? Every one of you can do any miracle Jesus did. And I pray for that blind man. That's what I heard the Holy Spirit say to me. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth in me, the works that I do, shall he do, and even greater works, because I go to my Father. Hello? I didn't even know that scripture is in the Bible. But I heard it just as clear as day. And so I said, God, what do I do? And he said, lay your hands on him. Well, I laid hands on lots of people. I used to be a boxer. I thought, God, you've got to be joking me. You want me to lay hands on him? And he said, yeah, but very, very gentle. A good thing he said that, because I'd have knocked the guy from the off his seat in the name of Jesus. Glory be to God. And so I laid my hands on him as gently as I know how. And I said, what do I do? And he said, command the blind devil to come out in Jesus' name. So I did, and the man jumped up and started shouting, I see, I see. Hallelujah. And so I started jumping and shouting, glory to God, it worked. Go with me to Mark's Gospel. Mark's Gospel, 11th chapter. And verse 22. And Jesus answering saith unto them, have the faith of God. Now, do you have the faith of God? We just got done reading, you do, don't we? Didn't we? Isn't that right? Every one of you got the faith of God. Isn't that right? If you're a born again believer, you got the faith of God. Now, the next verse tells you how it works. Verse 23. For verily I say unto you, now we got any yous in here? Turn to your neighbor there and say he's talking to you. You're a you, aren't you? So he's talking to you. You know, the biggest mistake people make is when they study this Bible, they say, who's God talking to here? He's talking to you. I like to look at my Bible as God's love letter to me. Not to somebody else, to me. Huh? Hallelujah. And so he's talking to you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever, that includes you also, don't it? Huh? Whosoever shall say unto this mountain, what are you going to say to the mountain? Be thou removed and cast into the sea. Now the verb here in the Greek says to say it and continue to say it till it literally moves. Hello? Now Jesus didn't have to do that because his faith level was developed to the highest level anybody's ever walked this earth. But our faith level ain't there yet. So we may have to speak 100 times to that mountain. We may have to speak 1,000 times to that mountain. And depending on where we're at, how much information we've got. Isn't that amazing? Glory be to God. Whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast in the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart. Now, what would cause you to doubt in your heart? Taking your focus off from the Word of God and off from Jesus. Isn't that right? And putting it on your problem. Now, how can you tell what you're focused on? By listening to what's coming out of here. If you're focused on Jesus, Jesus is going to come out of here. If you're focused on your problem, the problem's going to come out of here. Isn't that right? You can only focus on one thing at a time. Isn't that right? You try to focus on two things at a time and all you end up is confusion. Double-mindedness. You know, Bible said the wise man built his house on a rock. Isn't that right? Now, the wise man is the person who's made a decision to be a hearer and a doer of the word. And he built everything he believed on Scripture. Hello? On the Word of God. He built his healing on the Word of God, not on a feeling. Most people do not receive healing because they base their healing on a feeling and not on the Word of God. And if they don't feel healed, they won't confess their healing. Well, no scripture says you can know you're healed because you feel it. Hello? Isn't that right? There's no scripture says you can know you're healed because you feel it. How did you get saved? Did you get saved by feeling? How did you get saved? By believing with your heart and confessing with your mouth. Well, how do you get healed? The same way. The same way. Isn't that right? How do you get blessed? The same way. Isn't that amazing? And you can only believe what you're hearing. So if your hearing's wrong, your believing's going to be wrong. Isn't that amazing? I had a woman come up one night. She said, pray for me. She said, God bless me with this cancer. Where did she hear that? She didn't hear from the Holy Spirit. I said, fine, I'll pray for you. I'll pray that you'll go home tonight, lay hands on your husband, he'll get cancer. You'll lay hands on your children, they'll get cancer. You'll lay hands on your mother and father, they'll get cancer. She said, are you crazy? I said, sweetheart, God blesses you so you can be a blessing to others. So I said, that's such a great blessing, why don't you pass it on? But I said, I don't want it. Don't bless me with it, because I don't want it. Glory be to God. Isn't that amazing? I mean, boy, it's amazing some of the things I get asked to pray for. One guy asked me in Melbourne that I'd pray that he'd never sin again. Young man. I said, fine, I'll pray that. And I said, I'll pray that as soon as I say amen, you drop dead right there. No. I said, well, sir, the only people I know that never sinned again is dead people. Isn't that really amazing? One lady wanted me to pray unspoken requests. I said, sorry, I don't pray for unspoken requests. She finally said, well, I want you to pray that God will let me divorce my husband. I said, sorry, I can't pray that prayer. Isn't that amazing? I mean, some of the stuff you get asked, it's absolutely amazing. Glory be to God. You can tell they don't read the Bible. Now listen to this. Shall not doubt his heart, but shall believe. Now you notice he went from faith to believing. Why? Well, what you believe in your heart and confess in your mouth will determine whether your faith works. Hello? Faith alone won't do anything. Faith alone is dead. Tells you that in James. Okay? So, if you don't believe what God said in His Word with your heart and confess that with your mouth, your faith will never produce it. See, believing is what your problem is. It's not faith. It's what you believe that's shutting your faith down and keeping them from producing great things. I have people come up and say that they don't hear from God. I said, well, either you or God lied. Bible said, my sheep hear my voice. But you're saying you don't. So either you or God is telling a lie. Do you know that you hear from God all the time? You want to know what the problem is? You're tuned into the wrong frequency. God is spirit. He talks to your spirit, not your flesh. And you try to figure out what he said with your flesh. The minute you said, I wonder if that was God, switched off the flesh, off the spirit. I never had a problem with that. I never doubted that the Holy Spirit was speaking to me. And at that time, I didn't even know the word. There were some times I said to God, confirm that with the word. And he did. Every single time. Hallelujah.
Verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things that he saith shall come to pass, is that my life. He said that those things, if I believe that those things I say shall come to pass, I shall have whatsoever I say. You know, I was in Sri Lanka. I was taken to the hospital to pray for a man dying of leukemia. Now, almost every pastor had been there to pray for this young man and couldn't get him healed. So they told the family that it was God's will for him to die. They told the family to pray a prayer and release him to God. Only one problem. There is no such prayer in the Bible. Hello? It don't tell you anywhere to pray and release him to God. What you've done when you prayed that prayer is turn him right over to the devil. Hello? God not the thief. Are you not the killer? Hello? The thief is. Hallelujah. And so anyway, I said to the man, I said, sir, Jesus Christ come to this room today to heal you. And I'm saying to you tonight, listen to me, I'm saying to you tonight, Jesus Christ come here today to heal you. I don't care if you've been praying for 900 times, today is your day for healing. And you can receive it right here tonight in this place. Hello? Do you understand? Hallelujah. Healing presence of the Lord is here. And so the Bible said how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Well, the same God that's with Jesus is with us. Isn't that right? And so and the same anointing that Jesus had is with us. Hallelujah. And so I said to this man, I said, God, that Jesus is here today to heal you. And he said, oh, he said, I know God can do anything. I said, well, even the devil knows that. But I said, it doesn't do him any good. And it certainly ain't doing you any good. I said, do you know what Jesus Christ will do right here today? No. I said, well, pick that Bible up in Mark 11:23 and read it to me right out loud. So he read it. Verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast in the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. I said, sir, every person that's walked through that door into this room for the last 9 months should talk to you about the leukemia. You prayed about the leukemia. I said, is that what the Bible said to do? No. I said, what did the Bible say to do? He said, to say, leukemia, be thou plucked up with a root and cast into the sea. I said, why didn't you say that? He said, well, I didn't even know that scripture was in the Bible. I said, well, you know it now. I said, let's do it right now. He said, all right. So I laid my hands on him. I took authority over the leukemia, told it to go to the sea, and it was gone. Well, now, that if I hadn't been there and prayed for that man, he'd have died, and then he got up there and said, God did it. Well, God didn't do it. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. I had a man one time. I said, there's a man here. You've got a severe heart problem. And I said, get up and come down here. And he never moved. And finally, I called that out about 8 times. He never moved. I said, God, do you want me to point to him? He said, no. He's got to take a step of faith. He never came. Next morning, he died of a massive coronary. Now, I'm as sure as I stand here, the preacher got up and said, God did it. Hello? But God didn't do it. God does not determine when you die. You do. The first commandment that God gave that had a promise tied to it was honor thy father and mother, so shall you live long on the earth. So God's will is that you live long on the earth. And he said the number, there's several scriptures telling you the number of your days he will fulfill, but every promise of God's got a condition tied to it. Isn't that right? Every promise, even salvation, you've got to believe your heart and confess to your mouth. And that's what he's saying right here. You see, if you've got to believe your heart, confess your mouth. And he said, if you believe it with your heart and say it with your mouth, you shall have whatever you say. So if you walk down here and say, pray for my sickness, what are you going to get? You're not going to get healing. Why? You're not believing for healing. You didn't give your faith no job to do. Isn't that right? You remember the woman with the issue of blood? She was sent home to die, and she heard about Jesus. She said, I'm going to go to Jesus, I'm going to touch the hem of his garment, and when I do, I'm going to get healed. Isn't that right? Now, what was she doing? Giving her faith a job to do. I went to Nepal 2 years ago in the spring, and there was a man there in Nepal who had one kidney totally shot, the other one was about half shot. The doctor said, no hope for him, he can't find my kidney donor, and so he's going to die. Yeah. And so he heard about me coming to Nepal, so he made a decision that he was going to come to my meeting, and when I prayed for him, God was going to heal him. He gave his job of faith a job to do. Well, when I came to Nepal, he fasted for 3 days before I came to his church. I was up here preaching, and about halfway through my sermon, I stopped and I said, the man with the kidney problem, get up, come down here now. God's going to heal you. He walked down there. I laid hands on him, prayed for him. He went to the doctor 2 days later for his dialysis. The doctor came out and said, you don't need no dialysis. You've got 2 perfectly good working kidneys. And that same Jesus is right here in this place tonight. Hello? That same Jesus right here in this place tonight. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Now, read verse 24. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. Now, do you believe that scripture? Do you believe that scripture? Okay, if you believe that scripture, why do you pray over and over the same prayer? Hello? Do you know that Mark 11, 24 follows Mark 11, 23? And what did Mark 11, 23 say? Whatever you believe in your heart and confess in your mouth, you shall have whatsoever you say. So if you believe that, then why aren't you saying that you're healed? When do you got to believe that you receive? Can you tell me? What did the scripture say? When do you got to believe? When you pray, not when you feel it, not when the doctor gives you a clean bill of health, but when you pray. So if you believe that, then why aren't you doing Mark 11, 23? Why don't you, when the man says amen, when he prays for you, why don't you put your hands up there and praise and thank God for your healing? Hello? You know, if you did that, it wouldn't be long, you'd feel it. Hello? Glory be to God. You know, the Bible said Abraham grew strong in faith, giving glory to God. Now, he had no physical evidence to base his faith on. His wife's womb was dead, and he knew it. His body was dead, unable to produce children. He knew it. But he did not consider that, the Bible said. He only considered who God was, what God said, and the faithfulness of God to keep his promise. That's all he considered. Isn't that amazing? And as because he believed God, you're sitting here tonight, born again believers. You're the seed that God promised to Abraham way back there in Genesis 12. Because he believed God. Hallelujah. Give praise and glory for every one of us before he even saw us in the natural. Hallelujah. Isn't that amazing? See, he didn't wait till the baby was born, then give God the glory. You know, people say God put the sickness on you so you can get some glory out of it. Well, you know, I never read in the Bible any place where a sick person glorified God. But I did read where they got healed, they glorified God. Isn't that right? And so, tonight, you got great faith. That's not faith that's been keeping you from getting healed when you get prayed for. It's what you believe. You know, I had a man come up in Kuala Lumpur, took his glasses off, and he said to me, I believe if you pray for me, God will heal me. And the Holy Spirit said to me, he doesn't believe that. So I just mumbled a few words over and went on. And I was staying with this man. So 3 days later, I come down the stairs, and he's sitting there reading the newspaper with his glasses on. I said, what are you doing? He said, well, I believe God's going to heal me someday. I said, well, that's what you believed 3 days ago. That's why you didn't get healed. If you're believing God's healing you someday, it's not faith. It's hope. Hope is future tense. Faith is now. Hello? I go to churches sometimes, and the pastor gets up there and says, how many people expecting something tonight? Every hand in the place goes up. I get up to preach and I said, everybody that raised your hands lying except the pregnant women. I said, the pregnant women, the only ones expecting something. All right? I said, how many are believing for something? I said, that's what you're going to get, is what you believe for. That's what your faith is going to produce. So your faith tonight can produce your healing right here in this place, by giving it a job to you. Walk down here and say, Brother Howard, I believe if you lay hands on me and pray for me, God's going to heal me. No, that's not too hard to do. It's no harder to do that and say, Brother Howard, pray for my sickness. Isn't that right? Glory be to God. In the first place, I don't want your sickness. So why would I pray for it? What do you want me to pray? God, let this sickness kill him quickly. Glory be to God. No, I was not told by the Holy Spirit to pray for my sickness. He said to pray for the healing. Pray for healing, not for sickness. Your sickness don't need prayer. Maybe that's why you're still sick. You've been praying for it. Glory be to God. Isn't that amazing? See, you've got great faith. It's not a problem of faith. It's a problem of what you believe. Hallelujah. And so if your believing's wrong, you shut your faith down. Just like those people in Israel did when they heard those 12 spies. And God didn't shut their faith down. It wasn't God's will they end up out in the wilderness. It was God's will they go to the promised land. And so God said here, when you whatsoever things you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them. So if you believe you receive when you pray, then why aren't you praising and thanking him for receiving them? You know, that prayer that we sang partially tonight there about hallowed be thy name and stuff. If you look at the end of that prayer starts off with worship and praise, and it ends with worship and praise. Thanking God for the answer. That is not a prayer that we repeat over and over. Hello? God told you in that same chapter, don't pray in vain repetition. That is not a prayer that we pray over and over again. It's 7 steps on how to pray biblically. What it is. Hallelujah. It starts off with praise and worship and finishes with thanksgiving. Thanking God for the answer to that prayer. See, acting and talking like you believe you receive when you pray. And if you believe that, then you ought to be praising and thanking God after the prayer, thanking him every day until it manifests for the answer. Acting like you receive it. Hallelujah. And so if you do that, you put your faith to work, keep it on the job, and the Bible said, hold fast your confession of faith, for he is faithful who made the promise. Hold fast. Isn't it amazing? Go with me to 1 Timothy 6. And verse 12. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast confessed a good confession before many witnesses. Now, if you're ever going to lay hold on what eternal life is provided for you, you're going to have to fight the good fight of faith. See, if you're not in Christ, if you're not in Christ, you can't claim a single promise in your Bible. Every promise in your Bible was made to Abraham and his seed, which is Jesus Christ. And if you in Christ, then you're Abraham's seed. So if you're not in Christ, then there is no promises in the Bible for you. So you can't claim them if you're not in Christ. But the Bible said you are in Christ. You're hid by God in Christ. Your life is hid by God in Christ. Isn't that right? And so you're in Christ, so that means you're an heir of God, a joint heir with Jesus Christ of every promise in your Bible. Hallelujah. And so if you're going to receive them, appropriate them in your life, then you're going to have to fight the good fight of faith. Isn't that right? Hallelujah. And so how can you do that if you don't know how? I would say, hold fast your confession of faith. Hold fast your confession of faith. In other words, the Bible tells you to be single-minded. Isn't that right? Not double-minded. You know, people, a lot of places I go, the people are double-minded. I'm healed, I'm sick, I'm healed, I'm sick, I'm healed, I'm sick. Why don't you make up your mind? Why don't you make up your mind? My God supplies all my needs, I'm poor. My God supplies all my needs, I'm poor. My God supplies all my needs, I'm poor. Now, listen to me. Most places I go around the world, and most churches I go to, the lifestyle of the people in that church is up and down like this. That shows that you're building your house on the sand. Hello? You're building your belief system on your flesh, your human reasoning, and not on the Word of God. Hello? The wise man built his house on a rock and it didn't go up and down like this. Isn't that right? Hallelujah. And so, if you don't build it, it's up to you to build your house. And so, if you don't build it on a solid foundation, the storms of life are going to blow it away. Hallelujah. Isn't that amazing? Now, go one more place, and I'm going to close with this. Don't get nervous. The longest I've ever preached is 17 hours. Philemon, Philemon, whatever you want to call it. Verse 6, that the communication of thy faith may become productive by the confession of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. Now, can I ask you a question? What are you supposed to be confessing? Every good thing you have in Christ Jesus. I'm sick. Do you have that in Christ Jesus? No? Then why are we confessing it? I'm poor, do you have that in Christ Jesus? No. I'm weak, do you have that in Christ Jesus? No. I got bad memory, you got a bad memory of Jesus? He got the mind of Christ. How can you have a bad memory? Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. See, you see, the problem is that we're confessing stuff that's not biblical. And so we're giving the devil the ammunition that he needs to shut us out. Do you know the Bible says you're snared by the words of your own mouth? Now, what's a snare? Can you tell me? A trap. Isn't that right? A trap. Now, the devil has no material to build a trap with, to trap you, unless you give it to him. You know how we give it to him? Can I show you how we give it to him? Don't eat this because it's fattening. Don't eat this because it causes cholesterol problem. Don't eat this because it causes high blood pressure. Don't eat this because it causes heart problem. Don't eat this because it causes cancer. Hello? Isn't that amazing? You know, I eat all that stuff that causes cholesterol problem. My doctor told me I have the best cholesterol count she's ever seen in her life. I ate so much salt in my food, it looks like it snowed on it. I'm having high blood pressure. God said it wasn't what went in my mouth that defiled my body. He said it's what come out of my mouth. But what comes out of your mouth? Words. Isn't that right? Words. See, we're giving the devil the ammunition that he used against us by the confession of mouth. That's what Adam and Eve did. Isn't that right? Adam and Eve had all the power, not the devil. The devil hasn't had any power for 2,000 years. The only power he's got is what we give to him. He got none of his own. Jesus said, all power in heaven and earth is in me. Well, he didn't take it to heaven. What did he do with it? He gave it to us on the day of Pentecost. Isn't that right? All power in heaven and earth is you got it, not the devil. You're powerful people. Hello? Hear me? You're powerful people. Hallelujah. You got great faith. Well able to do anything that Jesus did. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, I used to be afraid of making a mistake. And the Holy Spirit told me one day, he said, son, I've done every mistake you'll ever make coming. You didn't have to worry about making a mistake. He said, I took care of that at Calvary. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. So I stopped worrying about making mistakes. I used to worry about what people thought about me. One day the Holy Spirit said to me, he said, well, what are you worried about what people think about you? You never worry about what people said about you when you were a sinner. All right? No, when people said something I didn't like, I just gave you the five-fold ministry. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And so, God said here, now how do you communicate something? Can you tell me? How do you communicate? Huh? With your words? Okay. Sir, I love you. Boom! Now what did I communicate? Did I communicate love? No. So how did I communicate? Words and actions. Hello? Now that's what the problem is. See, we're confessing the word of God to God, and then we're acting contrary to what we're saying with our actions. And God sees no faith. He only sees faith when both your words and your actions agree together. Hello? You know, we sing a song, huh? Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. We take up an offering and we put in 20 cents. Wow, what a big God you serve. Glory be to God. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. We take up the offering, huh? And you put in a dime. Huh? Glory be to God. Hallelujah. What a big God you got. Uh-huh. Thank you, Jesus. Now, so you communicate with words and actions, and if you're ever going to possess what you have in Christ Jesus, for your faith to produce that, both your words and your actions have to agree with the Word of God. Hello? Isn't that amazing? See, that's why Jesus said he didn't only speak the word, he did the action. He backed that word up. Isn't that right? And so if you believe, you know, I have people say they believe in that Jesus heals, but they won't pray for people. Huh? Well, if you believe Jesus healed, why don't you pray for him? Yeah, but Brother Howard, what if he dies? A guy in Kuala Lumpur, a preacher, asked me that. He said, or he told me that. He said, Brother Howard, he said, I believe hands on this guy and prayed for him and he died. I said, well, he ain't going to get any healer than that. That's as healed as he ain't ever going to get. Isn't that right? He'd go to heaven, said. Isn't that right? He got totally healed. Huh? Glory be to God. I laid hands on a few of them and they died too. But then they'll stop me from praying for people. Hallelujah. Why? Well, God told me to go do it. And I just obeyed him. Hallelujah. I never have to ask God what I should pray for the sick. Why? He told me to do that 40 years ago or so. All I got to do is ask him how he wants to do it. And a lot of my healings never take place by me laying hands on them. I just stand up there and I say, there's somebody being healed of this, there's somebody being healed of this, somebody being healed of this, and they just get healed. Hallelujah. I've seen them get out of wheelchairs, all kinds of stuff, and I never touched them. But some of the greatest meetings I've had, I never touched anybody. And everybody in the place got healed. I've seen cloven tongues of fire come right down and set on top of people's heads. Hallelujah, meetings. I had a meeting in Nepal, they're still talking about it. And I had a meeting in Nathralia, in Australia. They're still talking about the night God visited Nathralia. Hallelujah. Within 5 minutes or so, everybody in that place was laying flat on the floor, seeing visions of heaven and all kinds of stuff. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. And that can happen right here in New Zealand. Why, God's the same all over the place. He's not the one God in New Zealand, another God in Australia, another God in America. He's the same God everywhere. Isn't that right? And he's here tonight, and he's here to heal, you know, or set you free, or whatever you need to be. He's here to meet your need. Hallelujah. And so tonight, put your faith to work. As I pray and close this meeting, make a decision that you're going to believe what you're going to believe for. Hello? And don't think it, say it. It didn't say you're going to get what you think. It said you're going to get what you say. Isn't that right? So say it. I'll go down in front of that meeting when that man God lays hands on praise for me. I'm going to be healed. Hallelujah. Then act on it. Come down here and get prayer for me. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come boldly tonight to the throne of grace. We come to that new living way, the blood of Jesus, right into the holy presence of God. We thank you for welcome, because you yourself have declared us righteous by faith in Jesus Christ. We don't have to do works to earn it. We are already declared righteous by faith in Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Father God, that you have already made every promise in the Bible available through Jesus Christ to every believer. Father, when we were sinners, our bank account was bankrupt. There was nothing in it. But Father, when we accepted Jesus Christ, you walked up to that bank account and filled it with every promise of God. And so every promise is available just by us believing with our heart and confessing with our mouth. No word of God is void of power. Every word is filled with the power to accomplish what it's sent to do. So this word will not come back to you empty that's been preached here tonight, but it will accomplish what it's sent to do. Father, people here are going to rise up and begin to give their faith a job to do. Every morning when they get up, they're going to believe God for finances or whatever it is they need, Father God, and they're going to give their faith a job to do, and it's going to do that job. Hallelujah. Father, the whole nation of New Zealand can be transformed by the faith of these people of God. Father God, hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's not hard. their work is easy. You said so. And you said, my sheep follow me. And so, Father God, we know that the God that was with Jesus is with us. Hallelujah. We're the temple that he lives in. And so, Father God, help us. Teach us how to use the anointing that you've given to us. We've got the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. And so, Father, we don't need the power. We just need information on how to use that power. And so, Father, teach your people how to use that power to do great miracles, signs, and wonders so that this world can be saved. Father God, you told in the scriptures that there's in the latter days, the whole nations would be born in one day. And that's going to take supernatural power, supernatural miracles to confirm the word of God. That's going to get whole nations converted in one day. Father, in my life ministry, I have seen whole towns, whole cities saved and baptized in the Holy Spirit and healed all in one night. In Taiwan, in India, in the Philippines, in Sri Lanka, I have seen whole entire villages saved in one night. And so, Father, I know that it can happen anywhere in this world because we serve the same God in every nation. You are the Lord God that healeth us. And so we thank you for it tonight in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Now, if there's any young ladies here tonight that are married and you can't have babies, I get highly successful praying for women to get pregnant. You know, the first woman I prayed for, according to medical science, she could not have babies. Everything that she could have a baby with is cut out of her by an operation. And when I prayed for her, I saw three babies. One in front of her, one on both sides of her. I said, sweetheart, you're not going to have one baby. You're going to have three of them. And they're not triplets, because if they were, they'd all be on one side. But they're not. They're one on both sides, one in front. So it's three separate births. The doctor who delivered the babies told her when she had the third one, he said, if you brought these babies to me and I hadn't delivered them and told me they were your babies, he said, I would call the police and have you arrested for kidnapping. He said, it's totally medically impossible for you to have babies. But he said, I delivered them, so what can I say? Hallelujah. See, there's nothing too hard for God. Hallelujah. I had a man who fell on the scaffold, 7 stories up on the building, shattered the whole half his skull, sticking to his brain like a pincushion. I prayed for him, and within 2 minutes, he's got a normal skull. Sitting up in bed, gets out of bed, and his family on their knees, and gets saved, and he emptied the whole 87 beds in that hospital worn out that day. The last person I prayed for, the little girl, burned all the skin off her body. Mother sitting there crying. I said, can I pray for your daughter? She said, we're Buddhists. I said, that's all right. Jesus loved Buddhists too. She said, all right. So I prayed for her, and the little girl's skin came back on her body. Mother got saved. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And so there's nothing too hard for God. I've seen every deadly disease known to man healed by the power of God. I've laid these hands in the middle of some of the most deadly diseases known to man, but I don't get them. That when that germ touches my body, they die. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. I've been poisoned 13 times and I'm still here. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. I got bit by a deadly spider over in Australia. It felt like somebody turned a blowtorch loose on my skin. And I just prayed and said, God, you said in the word of God, if I get bit by any deadly thing, it won't hurt me. And it just stopped. Burning stopped. Hallelujah. And so we got a great God.